As some of you may no doubt be aware, in a previous video on the Martini-Henry firing exercise, we explored the firing drills of pre- and post-1881. Now, the main difference between these two sets of drills was the inclusion of the word of command, fire, as the executive word to physically squeeze the trigger. The purpose of the drill today is to determine which of the two versions is more accurate.
Since I first began researching and exploring Victorian musketry, the question of the word of command fire, or lack thereof, always posed a most interesting topic for research. It seems clear to me that the reason why the word of command fire and the robotic reaction to a word of command was taken out of the firing exercise in the 1830s was because of the increased emphasis placed on actually aiming your weapon, which at the time was still the smoothbore percussion musket. If this lack of the word of command fire was intended to increase the effectiveness of the individual with his weapon, then why in 1881 did they reintroduce it? Perhaps it was because the pause had become so formalized that the original intent of it had become lost. As of yet, I've been unable to uncover a reason for this change. There must have been one, and I'd like to think that it had something to do with the effectiveness of the musketry.
In order to properly conduct the experiment, I'll need a word of command to respond to. For that, I'll enlist this little helper. By recording the words of command on it and playing them back, I'll have something to react to as part of the drill. Firing, in the first case, on the word of command present. Then, in the second practice, to fire on the word of command fire, as was introduced after 1881. All these practices will be conducted with the Mark I Martini-Henry, a rifle that some of you are no doubt familiar with.
Both practices would be shot with 10 rounds each, and for an appropriate amount of encumbrance, would be shot in full marching order. In this case, the full set of 82 pattern release equipment. I chose to use the paper patch rounds that I've recently developed. They consist of a paper patched 0.457 510 grain bullet. This is in front of 85 grains of 2F powder. For targetry, I chose the oft-used Pritchett International target. This has a useful size bullseye as it was placed at 100 yards. The first practice was volley firing using the word of command, present. As alluded to in the introduction, I used my phone with a voice recording of the appropriate words of command. This left an appropriate pause between ready and present to achieve loading.
Present!
As with all musketry practices, it's always a good thing to start with 2 rounds warming. This was done without much ceremony into the ground beside the target. The practice began in earnest using the recorded words of command. As alluded to in the previous video on the Martini-Henry firing exercise, the drills pre-1881 included a judged pause of 3 beats of slow time after the word of command present before the man pulled the trigger. As you can see, I was a little slow with that volley. Don't worry, the sergeant major had words with me off camera. Once I got into the rhythm, however, the 3-second pause, or rather the 3 beats of slow time, seemed to come quite naturally. One can only expect that with constant drilling, that 3 beats of slow time would be more than adequate for all the men of a given unit to aim and fire generally together. To be honest, I wasn't even counting the pause in my head. I took my time, aimed, and squeezed the trigger when the sights were aligned on the target properly. When you look at the techniques for volley firing with weapons that came before the Martini-Henry, namely the Enfield and the Snider, there's no stipulation specifically of a pause equal to 3 beats of slow time. In fact, the only mention is that no hurry should be taken. One wonders, therefore, for the formalization of this pause. Firstly, to a judged 3-beat pause, as shown in this practice, and finally changing to a formal pause with the command fire at the end, as will be practiced next.
So from a shooting standpoint, I'm anticipating that the pre-1881 drills, well, theoretically should be more accurate, without the constraint of having to fire on the word of command fire, and to a certain extent being allowed to take what time you need to achieve your correct sight picture. The theory behind that would indicate that the performance of a given individual with his rifle would be better. But as they say, the proof will be in the pudding. So there's the first 10 rounds fired using the pre-1881 drills, whereby we fire after the word of command present in a timely fashion, though on your own time.
By this, of course, I'm referring to that judged 3 beats of slow time. For judging the accuracy of these two practices, I elected to use the tried and true method of determining the figure of merit. This, more than any other method, determines the consistency of a given rifle. Though requiring more work, it is a much better method than using simple group size.
The next group we'll shoot is using the post-1881 drills. In this evolution, the word of command fire follows the word of command present, using a 3-second pause to give time for aiming. Again, I'll be using the trusty phone to give the word of command to myself. Ready!
As with the previous practice, there was an appropriate pause made between the word of command ready and present to enable time for loading.
Let's see how we do.
Because of the camera angle and the distance in some of these shots, the recording of the words of command didn't necessarily come through. It's been dubbed in for clarity.
Ready!
You'll notice at times that in this practice I fired at the first instant of the word of command fire. Other times you'll notice I fired when the word of command was finished.
Ready!
Now I can't really explain what motivated me either way. There's no mention in the text of this particular aspect, though firing immediately after the word of command feels slightly more natural.
Fire! That was the grouping fired using the post-1881 drills. I can't say for sure at this point whether or not it's going to be worse or, in fact, better. There is a slight degree of constraint that you feel when you're firing volleys in this fashion. That it focuses you a little bit more because you know the word of command is coming. But when it does come, you're not necessarily exactly where you want to be aiming. Now, granted, the application of volley fire, necessarily by its weight of fire, in the fact that there's a number of people shooting at once, perhaps can rely on a bit more of volume rather than accuracy to achieve hits on various targets. But generally speaking, these rifles are capable of hitting what they are aimed at. And, well, I think the constraint might have put a little extra pressure on me. So this group here, quite a bit larger. Seems to be easing to the left a little bit, but that's the way the rifle is zeroed. I think that I can probably explain, looking back at the grouping I shot, that perhaps I was easing a bit left, inadvertently, mind you. But the spread here from, like so, quite a bit a greater dispersion on this group. Interesting results, anyway.
As mentioned before, the results were calculated using the figure of merit calculator. The results for practice number one were as follows. A figure of merit of 3.38 inches was calculated in a group size of 9.46. The results for practice number two were somewhat less inspiring. The group, or rather pattern, was spread out over 20 inches, and the figure of merit of 5.19 inches was somewhat less than satisfactory. I suppose the proof as to which set of drills was more effective would lie in the weapon's performance on the battlefield. Were the volleys fired by the 24th foot at Islandwana any less effective than those fired by the Camel Corps in the Sudan campaign of 1885? I suppose that they were not, and, with proper drill and training, any difficulties would quickly be overcome. I'd certainly be interested in hearing your thoughts if you care to leave them in the comments below.